Well, aloha, New Hope Windward. I want to welcome all of you to our different locations. I'm going to be away today, and so I'm excited to announce today's guest pastor. Many of you know of him already. His name is Pastor Norman Nakanishi, and he is a great, great pastor. He happens to be the founding pastor of one of the largest Grace Bibles on the island. It is called Grace Bible Pearlside, and yes, you guessed it, it's located in Pearl City. And he has helped me so much over the years as he's mentored me through the different seasons of life. And so I was so thankful to hear that he'd be available to share today. And so New Hope Windward, would you do what you do so well? Give a warm New Hope Windward aloha and welcome to one of God's all-star pastors who is in the house, Pastor Norman Nakanishi.
Aloha New Hope Windward. These are the best church seats I have ever seen. I have to ask you a question because they said I could go 2 hours in the message in this last service. Do they allow you to recline in during worship? They do? God bless you. Amen. Well, I want to just show you my family. So just so you get to know a little bit about me, because you might think, who's that strange guy up there? The tall, good-looking guy to your left with the coat, that's my son-in-law, Billy Lyle. In fact, he's overseeing the services there at our place. We have Joanne Ann Onosai speaking for us as I speak here. That's my daughter, Naomi, carrying the baby. This is about a year old, so things have changed. My two little grandchildren, Micah, who's a basketball phenom, and Madison. And the two girls in the end are available. They're single. All right. This is my wife of 38 years, out of which we've had 35 happily married years. 3 years were rough. And that's me. She's from Marinal, and I'm from Kalihi. I graduated from Farrington. I can read and write. And so this is a really good deal. And I just wanted to get a little bit of fabric with me. It's such an honor to be here. My wife would be here, but she has a bad case of bronchitis. Doctor says stay home, rest, and be still and heal. New Hope, your impact has been huge. The New Hope family, yes, but your church here, with its immense setup and being in theaters and having to have the immense challenges and reaching the people you've reached is epic. You need to know, because Pastor Dave can't come over here and brag about you, but we can brag about you. And you are an amazing church. You are talked about everywhere. Give yourselves a hand. Truly, truly. Okay? Because you're not here by accident. And sometimes because of that, as a family, the enemy of our soul tries to bring division where God wants to have unity. He attacks marriages and friendships and businesses. He attacks courtships. He attacks everything, but God is greater than that. But the Lord also gives us a map in which we navigate relationship conflict. I went to Kalakaua School before going to Farrington. Kalakaua was at one time the largest intermediate school and middle school in the state. I was the student body treasurer. That's what they do. They make Asians treasurers. It's a stereotype. So I got hijacked a lot. And one day I was in front of the school trying to get home, because we would kind of scheme how to kind of escape the gangs, you know. And I had a friend with me who was really a close and dear friend for years. And they hijacked him, which at first I went, phew. And then he went, I don't have any money, but why don't you hijack Norman? Because he's got a lot of money. And I went, I was so shocked and offended by that. And here was a guy that I felt like was a brother, all right? And so I realized then the power of forgiveness, that even as an adolescent teenager, do I want this to end our friendship, or is there a way around it? You know, brothers can bless you, but sometimes they can betray you. And you go, well, wow, that is true, but it's very true when you look in the book of Genesis. The book of Genesis, the patriarch Jacob, one of the fathers, has 12 sons. The 11th of 12 sons, his name is Joseph. His 10 older brothers don't like him. They're jealous of him because he's the favored son. And Joseph has dreams. He's given the best clothes. I mean, he is it. And his brothers hate him so much so, there comes a day. Scripture says that they plot to actually kill him. But then the older brother goes, no, that's a little extreme. Let's just throw him into a pit and sell him. A little bit of an upgrade. Long story short, they sell Joseph into slavery. He becomes a servant slave in the house of Potiphar. Potiphar is the captain of the guard, head of the secret service, serving Pharaoh, the leader of the mightiest nation on the planet. Joseph has favor there until Potiphar's wife accuses him of rape. She tries to come on to him. He's not having any of it. He's a God-fearer. He respects and honors God. She trashes him. Potiphar believes his wife, throws Joseph into prison. Again, betrayal. This is a bad, bad experience on many levels. Joseph in prison is probably having all kinds of weird thoughts because he's human. Put yourself in Joseph's shoes. What would you be thinking? What would you be feeling? My brothers, my boss, I've done nothing wrong and they're treating me like trash. God, where are you? Maybe he battled some anger towards the Lord. I don't know. If he's as human as you and I know I would have, right? So he's there and then he's forgotten in prison. He asks for a favor from a fellow prisoner and that person forgets. But then there comes a day, because there's always a day. God never forgets about us. Pharaoh has a dream. Joseph's able to tell him the dream and interpret it. And immediately, he's promoted as head of the kingdom. He goes from the prison to the palace in a moment. 13 years after he first has these dreams that causes his brothers to hate him and throw him into the pit. I don't know where you are today, but God has not forgotten about you. You may feel like you're in the prison or in a pit. God has a palace for you because you are his masterpiece and you are designed for a purpose. You are designed for impact. You are not in New Hope Windward by accident. You are in New Hope Windward for destiny. And that excites me. And because of that, the enemy of our soul will try to decimate relationships. He'll try to bring division where there's unity. And from Joseph, we can surmise a journey that we want to take this morning. I think he realized that, first of all, there has to be forgiveness. That's a hard word. We call it in our church the F word. I hope this is not the one that gets on video. Because that has offended people. But as I look at you, I just feel a little bit Kalihi Mana coming. Okay? Because it's a hard word. The Apostle Paul said about forgiveness. Here's how it works. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, patience, bearing with one another. And if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Wow. That's a lot of forgiving. Forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven you, which means unconditionally. Unconditionally forgive. So you also must forgive. Look how important forgiveness is. We'll come back to this. The disciple Peter, the apostle who would become the apostle Peter, approaches Jesus one day in the Gospels. And Peter has an anger issue. Peter is a guy who could handle himself. Scholars say this guy was a middle linebacker. You know, punch first, talk later. And Peter approaches Jesus because he's having some issues about this touchy-feely forgiveness thing. And so Peter comes, but the Bible says Peter came up to Jesus and said to him, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Okay, he's got an agenda, as many as 7 times. And Jesus said to him, I do not say to you 7 times, but 77 times. Other translations say 70 times, 7 times. That's a lot of times. Well, Peter knows Jewish law. It's in the back of his mind. You forgive 3 times and then you can exact subtle retribution. 3 times is all that's required. So he's being noble. Let's stretch it out as I approach the master. 7 times? Jesus goes, no. He knows where Peter's coming from. He says, no, Peter, you forgive as often as it takes for change to come in your soul. Okay? Now let's go back to where the first passage we were at. Paul says, here's how these virtues work, among which is unconditional forgiveness. You put on forgiveness. You put on. That term in the original language means literally as if you put on a coat or a garment, an outer garment. I was in Washington, D.C. speaking about 3 weeks ago to a fairly large church full of NFL people, FBI, NSA, CIA, and with all those letters. And they all wear suits. Dude, I don't wear suits. So this is a friend of mine. I serve on a national team. He's a leader of our North American leadership team. So I got to wear a coat. Got to go buy a coat from Calvin Klein. I don't shop. I hate shopping. Okay. Get a coat and I have to put it on. I don't feel like wearing a coat. Plus in D.C. it's hot. Why do you wear a coat to church when it's hot? Okay, it's hotter than here, but it's culture. So I don't want to offend. As I'm putting on the coat, I go, I don't feel like wearing this coat. I don't want to wear this coat. It's stupid to wear this coat. It's so hot. It's 90 degrees outside. And I'm from Hawaii. Give a brother a break. Well, that's what forgiveness is. You put on the outside the act of forgiveness, even though you don't feel like it. And Jesus is saying, Peter, put it on 70 times, 7 times. 77 times. What is the principle? He's saying, Peter, forgiveness is not an emotion, it's a decision. And you keep making that decision to forgive until what's on the outside gets on your insides. Because faith, you can act your way by faith, and faith pleases God. You can act your way into genuine feelings of forgiveness. I've been a Christian for over 40 years. I've been a believer over 40 years. And I can tell you, it works. If you work it by the grace of God. For those of you that are new this morning, you're a seeker and you got dragged here. I get it. You're going, oh man, I don't want to hear this. Listen, I've been where you've been. But the Son of God, Jesus, died for our forgiveness. He who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God. It is the gospel. And God says, you're going to be living embodiments of the gospel. Forgiveness is necessary to make sure our prayers are answered. Forgiveness is necessary that we don't get sick. We have doctors in our church that say it's proven now by researchers that holding resentment into bitterness causes such a physiological, hormonal, chemical reaction in your body, it does lead to arthritis, cancer, and other diseases. Our bodies were never meant not to forgive. We're never meant to contain resentment so that it affects us so badly we become sick. Researchers have said that as much as 67% of hospital beds are filled with people whose diseases have roots in resentment and unforgiveness. Did you know that? It's amazing stuff. Okay, you can Google that these days. And so this is an amazing journey. Forgive. Now, here's a little bit of motivation to forgive, and I don't want you to take this wrongly. When we forgive, we actually place the other person in the Lord's hands, and the Lord will lovingly, because he loves them, deal with it. While he deals with us, he deals with them. Romans 12:19 says, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. Wrath, that's a very strong word. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. I've found over the years nobody gets away with anything. Listen, if you lived as long as I lived, and I'm 63. I know I look 43 and I act 23, all right? But listen to me. No one gets away with anything. And I have found, though it takes a while, if people don't come around, God, because he loves them, will bring them around, but not till we forgive them. It's amazing. It's like forgiveness triggers the beginning of a restoration. It's hard because there's feelings involved that are very emotional. I'll give you an example. Years ago, I was called to, there was a woman in our church who was married to one of the most powerful men in Hawaii and one of the richest men in Hawaii. And a Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous episode shoot, it was a famous show that was being filmed back in the day, was coming to do his life. So there was some demonic activity on the property, which was in Kahala. If you know anything about Kahala, some of those homes are built on heiaus, Hawaiian burial grounds. And so as we went in with a big prayer team, we were able after hours to stop the demonic manifestations. The woman who was married to the man had 5 children. We were able to lead them into faith in Jesus Christ because they were scared out of their mind. It was a great moment until the guy came home. And he didn't know I was there. He didn't know I was invited there. And it's this huge estate. He walks up to me with his staff watching. He's got about 15 or 16 butlers, cooks, waitresses, maids. And he begins to go off on me. He comes right up into my face and starts It's kind of a big guy down here. I'm a little guy. And he's spitting in my face. And he's got this big finger coming at me. And I had a vision. You believe in visions and dreams? We live in the age of the Holy Spirit. Here's mine. In the vision, I was biting his finger like a pit bull and shaking it. True story. That's not a vision from God. The veins on the side of my neck were bulging. I felt the blood rush to my face. That's not what I'm used to. In fact, from where I grew up, you don't ever do that. I don't care how small the guy is. And so in my mind, I went, preacher, walk your talk. I forgive you. I forgive you. I was proclaiming the F word. I forgive you. I forgive, not the other F word, this F word. I forgive you. I forgive you. Now, what was my body telling me? Bite the finger. But my mind was a decision. I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you. And then something happened. I got levitated. You know, in the Bible, people got translated, right? And I would imagine they got levitated. Literally, got lifted off my feet. And I can remember that because that was so startling. My legs began to dangle. I'm 5 feet five, all right? And I began to be taken not only out of the room, but out of the house. Well, he had five sons. His oldest son was a college football player. He had actually picked me up when his dad was doing this. He actually picked me up and carried me with my legs dangling out of the house. And then like a dog, he told me, stay there. And don't come back in until I tell you it's safe. Why is this? The man was an attorney. And he's been in situations before where bad things happen and you can't beat this guy. And you're on my dad's property. He's got it over you. I mean, he took me out so there wouldn't be any physical contact, even an incidental brush. I'm shaking. I'm shaking not because I'm scared. I'm shaking because I'm mad. And yet, you can hear the Lord going, choose to forgive unconditionally right now because bad things could happen. You know, I found out right then I wasn't as holy as I thought. You can take the kid out of Kalihi, but you can't take the Kalihi out of the kid. That's a process, okay? You people in Kanehuhi are a lot purer. All right. You have to understand, when we have Farrington High School reunions, everybody goes to the reunion, whether you graduated or not. Okay? That's how it is. We believe in inclusion. Here's the sad part. A few years after that, he got a stroke, heart attack, and he died. Not because of what he did to me. I would discover that he had a history of just containing this belligerent resentment, unforgiveness. Emotions were inside of him. He had multiple marriages, conflicts that were never resolved, and the stress killed him in the end. And I was sad because my last words with him were not bad words at all. He actually expressed kindness to me. And I thought, you know, something in me went, man, I would love to have had an opportunity to bring closure to that. And God, only you know whether you did. But I say that to say there's things that can happen to us if we don't forgive. But also there's things that sometimes happen to those who don't forgive us, that if we'll just forgive them, God will deal with them. Hopefully not like that. Not like that. But there's such power in this, because the Lord so values unity in our relationships. He commands the blessing. So now, when we forgive, guess what happens next? We begin to heal. There's the healing of the heart. The heart is a muscle. And like any muscle that's torn or a bone that's broken, it takes time to heal. Healing takes time, and it takes time to heal. King Solomon writes in Ecclesiastes 3, for everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up. Forgiveness triggers healing, all right? And it's an ongoing, repeated cycle until our hearts are made completely whole. Joseph had 13 years to heal. Just when he was probably healing towards his brothers, he was accused of rape and thrown into the prison, a rape he never committed. He probably had to heal with some animosity towards God. I don't know about you, but I've been mad at God before. It's okay. King David, who writes many of the Psalms, expressed anger towards God. God already knows. It's like, I don't want God to know I'm angry at him. Hello, he's God. He already knows. Hello. So you may as well tell him. And there, in the telling of him in honesty, there's the healing, because confession brings healing. Honesty brings healing. And so I'm sure Joseph, when he was at the pit of prison, he probably, I'm surmising, shook his fist at God, thought about his brothers, thought about Potiphar. You couldn't believe me. I served him. I'm in prison. And then he gets that moment where his gift can operate. He interprets a dream, tells the dream, then interprets the dream, and he's promoted. Let me just say this. It's probably because his heart had healed and he could be trusted. Because in that top administrative position, he would have to know how to treat people well. You can't have carried toxicity and baggage from the past. He had gone from forgiveness into healing and God trusting him. When I began my ministry career in preparation, I graduated from the University of Hawaii with a teaching degree. I used to teach school, coach some sports, believe it or not, oversaw a Christian school in my past. But as I began to move into the ministry, I was accused by a person I thought was kind of friendly towards me of 13 things I had never done before. As I recall, it was a list of 13 things, because when they read a list and you're falsely accused, you remember. I was brought before the board of elders of the church that I was serving, where the Bible college was in. Pastoral staff was there. It was about a dozen of them sitting in what looked like an inquisition. The person was highly educated, had a tremendous position in the marketplace, and I was only 4 years, 3.5 years out of playing, being a drummer in nightclubs, gigging to get myself through school, college. And in those days, back in those days, in years previous, nobody played drums in church. In fact, I've been told I probably started it in Hawaii. I'm bragging, all right? I don't know if it's true. You know, back, and I got criticized for playing the drums. The choir director believed in me. He put me right on stage. Bad move. And I had all kind of people come after me, like, this is evil. Drums, those beats create lust. It caused people to think sexual thoughts. I was like, you gotta be kidding me. These loony Christians, you know what I mean? Because I was brand new in the faith. And so, anyway, who are you going to believe? You going to believe that person? You going to believe him? Or you going to believe me? And I'm thinking, why am I being accused of what? This is so ludicrous. I never did any of these things, but I'm sitting there. He's reading the accusations. I'm sitting there. The 12 elders are looking at me, and I'm going, I'm done. This is it. There's no way they're going to believe me. And there's this, it goes on. Then there's silence. The list is read. All of a sudden, my Bible college dean, this is a huge guy, stands up. He says, you're lying. He talks to the accuser. I go, yes. Right? And this was, you've had issues from your past that you haven't let go, where you've been offended, maybe even abused. And because you haven't forgiven, you're projecting onto Norman, because he reminds you of your previous offenders. I mean, he's going off like a prophetic. I'm like, yeah! Keep on going! Then it goes silent. And that silence was so uncomfortable. I began to say, will a brother help a brother here? Somebody say something. Senior pastor finally stands up. Norman, we believe you. Turn to the person. Let's help you get free. Person stood up, rushed out the door, slammed the door. And then it got uncomfortably quiet again. For what seemed to me like way too long. And you know what? That was it. You know what I was thinking? What about the 10 other guys? Who do they believe? Because they have a part in shaping my future. Who do they believe? What are they thinking? I would never have closure. 6 years later, all I knew is I had to keep forgiving. choose to forgive. Choose to forgive. Along the way, you know, you're kind of wondering when you see them around church or the campus, you go, what are they thinking? They believe him? Do they believe me? What are they thinking? And finally, you kind of hear the Lord go, well, it's really none of your business. Just keep putting on the coat of forgiveness. 6 years later, I get a call. The person is on the other line. I'm in therapy. I'm in a place that I'm being helped. And I've learned that I need to ask you to forgive me. I did lie. Every one of those things were false. I went, right. Will you forgive me? You have to ask the question. That's what they teach. You have to, will you forgive me? And that's it. And I realized immediately, I said, of course I forgive you. I forgave you back then, which was true. You have to. I didn't feel it, but I chose it. And I realized my heart had healed. And you don't even know it. Because you keep putting on the coat. And what was first only an act of faith on the outside became reality on the inside. That is the power of decisions made by faith, surrendered to God, when you say, God, help me. To make what's on the outside just a pure action become character on the inside. That's what happened to Joseph. As you'll see very shortly. Now, we'll close with this. If it's possible, God wants to bring a reconciliation of what was divided. The Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 12, live in harmony with one another, do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. And if possible, because it's not always possible, if possible, so far it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Let me be honest with you. In my position, having done what I'm done, it hasn't always been possible. I choose to forgive. I pray for my enemies, but they have chosen not to believe me. I cannot control them. But by forgiving them, I release the Lord by His Holy Spirit to work in them because He loves them. He does. He loves them. But there can be no reconciliation if they don't want to reconcile with me. At the same point, I can't reconcile. There's... It goes two ways, right? They may not want to reconcile with me, but there's some people I don't trust. I don't want to be reconciled with them. I forgive them, but it does not obligate me to trust them. Now, this is the bombshell part about this whole journey that I feel like sometimes we miss. Relationships that are fractured require forgiveness to maintain healthy. Because if we don't forgive, we are the ones who suffer because of the reaction it causes in us, emotionally and physiologically. Also, if we don't forgive, Scripture is clear in the Gospels, God won't answer our prayers. Okay? So think about that one. But in this whole area of forgiveness, reconciliation depends on trust. So often in Hawaii, because of our Aloha Spirit, we say, well, once we forgive, if you really forgive, you forget and you come back together, whether it's been a marriage, a friendship, a business partnership, but all relationships depend on trust. Without trust, there can be no reconciliation. And trust is conditional. Forgiveness is unconditional and immediate. Trust is gradual and conditional. Trust is earned. Forgiveness is given. Just because you forgive doesn't mean you're obligated to trust. This is the freeing thought, folks. We forgive. Listen, people who've violated me, all of them I forgive. Not all of them do I trust. And for those that I don't trust, I cannot reconcile with. And where I find a lot of people just go, they get this wrong, is they start reconciling way too early before the heart has healed and trust has been re-earned and reclaimed. Does that make sense? For Joseph, the Lord knew it would take 13 years before there could be a reconciliation. The guy I talked to you in the beginning in front of Kalakaua School, who threw me under the bus, We did reconcile. We played music together for years. Okay? And I got to tell you, there were some times I would look at him. You have these little, like, moments, and I would look at him, and I'm thinking, but you rise above that. I remember one of the great experiences I've had was being chaplain for the University of Hawaii football team under Coach Jones. Coach is a member of our church. And when I came in as chaplain in 2005 for Coach Jones and McMackin, the team was fractured. I mean, it was totally divided. The African Americans, the Caucasians, the local Polynesians, there are no Asians on the team, okay? For obvious reasons. all right, I'm okay with that. And there were fights in the locker rooms. And I remember Coach Jones just stopping practice, putting everybody in small groups, which here we at New Hope do. And he said, I want you to tell each other where you came from. And when they began to hear the abuse, the manipulation, because athletes go through all of this, the performance mentality, the judgment that they all came from, was miraculous. As they began to take time to hear each other's story, tears began to flow. And over time, hearts began to heal, and where there was division, there came unity. In 2006, they ended up tremendous season, top 25, and of course, 2007, we went to the Sugar Bowl. You know where the secret of that came? Those small groups taking time to cry with each other when they really took time to understand where the other person was coming from. There was forgiveness, the hearts healed, and then in unity, they were an amazing football team. That's what God wants the church to be. Well, there were 12 guys on this team. And we find here Joseph's now ready to face his brothers. His brothers, they're encountering famine in the land. Jacob, their patriarch daddy, saying, go to Egypt. They're providing grain there, and little do they know, Joseph, the brother they betrayed, is in charge. He's in total charge. But now it's time for the team to come back together. Let's take a look.
Leave us. I said, leave us. Get out.
Josh, come.
I am Joseph. Joseph. It is my brother Joseph. Be at peace. Come closer. Don't be afraid. I will not harm you. Am I to take the place of God?
Joseph.
It is not for me to punish you. You meant evil against me, yes. God meant it for good. To bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today.
That moment would become the genesis of the formation of the nation of Israel. The 12 brothers would become the seed from which eventually, out of suffering, the nation that will be the theater for the second coming of Christ that as we come to the end of this age will become the forum of world history and the end of an age. All of that comes from that. No wonder the enemy wanted to take Joseph out. No wonder such conflict. But Joseph was ready now. Interestingly, it took betrayal for character to be formed in him. It took the prison, it took the pit, it took false accusations to teach Joseph to be a type of Christ, to forgive unconditionally, let your heart heal. And then, at the right time, where he could trust his brothers, because he knew from a previous forays in touching base with them when they would come to him, they had changed. There's some relationships. I forgive everyone, but there's some relationships. I need to keep it in the trust oven. Not yet. In fact, some people want to get close to me right away, and I go, we're full of aloha. This is Hawaii. You want to go, yeah, land of aloha. Just come on, forgive and forget. And I feel like the Lord's going, not yet. They need to bake in the trust oven a little more. Let me work on them. Then again, on the other hand, the Lord's kind of convicting me about some people I need to re-embrace. Because this is Hawaii, right? Most important, this is Jesus. And I don't know where you are, but here's the deal. If at all possible, God wants a full reconciliation. It's not always possible. It's not always possible. My son-in-law that you saw on the screen, his name is Billy. His father was in prison. He was the only child. He ended up chasing my daughter when our church first started. We had like 30 to 50 people. My daughter was in the 7th grade. He was in the 8th grade. And how many of you know that's maybe too early to have a relationship? Yeah? So I wanted essentially to kill him, actually. Okay, son of a felon. Okay, that's not good. My princess will not, you know. You go through all of these things and then Lord said, no, you just embrace him. So we did. And he grew up to be a fine young man. But I remember when he broke down in tears in my living room at age 16. His dad was he was incarcerated, busted again. And I remember talking to his grandmother. And I remember saying all of these things, essentially. Well, guess what? Eventually, his dad got saved in prison. And today, he's on my staff. And Billy is his boss. Yeah, I know. Yeah, it's too good to be true. Unless the Lord's involved. So in staff meeting, get this. There's my daughter sits in a staff meeting. I'm the father-in-law, his father. We're all there together. So the other day I went, Bill, how you doing, man? He said, well, it can be complicated, but only God can pull that together. Let me close with this quick story. This is 4th of July weekend. And, well, the next few days, Hawaii, we make it a weekend. And I'm Japanese American. I have a mother at home with us with Alzheimer's. We're trying to care for us as long as we can. My dad passed away about a year ago. She's 89. But she has had all brothers and some fought in the war. World War II, December 7th, 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. And all Japanese Americans were viewed as traitors. They were interned. They were set aside, prejudiced. And the 100th Battalion, 442nd Combat Regiment units were formed, Japanese Americans, mostly from Hawaii, West Coast, to prove their loyalty, sent to Europe to fight on the battlefields. However, they were told to be expendable. But they'd rather die proving a point than live viewed as traitors. My uncle, Robert Nagata, passed about a year and a half ago at nearly the age of 95. He was 94. And he fought in one of the 10 most epic battles of World War II called the Battle for the Lost Battalion. The Lost Battalion was 275 Texans on the top of a mountain in the deep, dark forest called the Vosges Forest in France. 5,000 Nazis had ringed that area to take the higher ground, which is common military strategy. Regiments had tried to free the Lost Battalion twice before and failed, and it was commanded that the 142nd, though they were tired from two previous deployments, would be sent in, and my uncle knew because we were expendable. 1,000 Japanese American soldiers were to charge the hill, and I don't know if you showed the picture there. That's what it looked like. Imagine that's my uncle, right? Before he passed, he says, "I don't know how I climbed that mountain. I just don't know how I climbed that mountain." He never talked about it his whole life. And then towards the end, it just comes out. I just sit down right there. Don't go anywhere. And to make a long story short, 211 of the 275 Texans were rescued. Of the 1,000 Japanese American soldiers that tried to rescue them to charge the hill, 800 died in the attempt to rescue 275 Southerners who hated the Japanese. And there was some talk about, we're going to get them who know like us. But the commanders knew, this is our duty, this is why we signed up. We're not evil Japanese Empire people. We are Americans, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So let's go. Let's go for broke. And they did. They charged the hill. My uncle had survivor's guilt. He was given every medal except the Congressional Medal of Honor because he lived. And here is what I want to leave you with. What carried him through, he was collect all the chocolate from his fellow soldiers, because when they would go to free and liberate villages on the ground, he lived for having the children flock to him, and he could give them pieces of chocolate, and they just love the chocolate. He gave away all his cigarettes and all the paraphernalia, right? But he gave, and he remembered, that helped him remember why we fight, why we serve, is to set people free. We don't fight with each other. Even those guys up there that are trapped, they're our brothers. They don't act like it. They may not feel it. But this is why we signed up. Church, the enemy is not in here. It's not in our families. It's not in our marriages. It's not in our children. It's not in our business. It's the enemy of our soul that tries to let bitterness and unforgiveness and resentment fester way past the point that it should. Don't let him do it. Don't let him win. Immediately they go, "I forgive. Lord, heal my heart. And if possible, let there be a reconciliation." Can we bow our heads? You're here in the name of Jesus. You're here. And you say, I can't do that. None of us can unless we have the power of the Holy Spirit and the Lord Jesus Christ living in us by His Spirit. It's called being born again. And if you're here, you've never received Jesus, I want to give you an opportunity a couple days before Independence Day to get free and have the power of God. The gospel is, if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, then by faith we must receive Him into our hearts, and we are born again, and His power begins to work. And if that's you and you're ready to cross the line of faith, then pray this prayer line by line as I pray it out loud. And I wonder if the Christ followers in the room to pray out loud with me to encourage any first timers that would be here. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Take over my life. I surrender to you as my Lord and my Savior. Give me the strength to live for you. I receive your cleansing and forgiveness and declare my life to be in your hands. In the name of Jesus, amen. Now, I want to say to you, if you prayed in your heart, God heard that prayer. After the service, there's the Next Steps Center or Next Steps table. You'll hear about that at the end of service. That next step is going to be your most important step because it will change your life. How do I know? 44 years ago, it happened for me. And I've never, ever looked back. But I want to play one more prayer. We've gone over time a little bit. I hope Pastor Dave won't scold me when he gets back. Father, what a church. I've stood here for three services, the anointing, the ohana, the Spirit of God, And your hand of ordination is on this church. And I pray for unity that the enemy cannot ever dissolve. Command a blessing here on every marriage, on every family, on every child, on every business, on every community endeavor, on this church. Father, where there are tensions in marriages between parents and children, husbands and wives, ministries, whatever it be the case, I just renounce the spirit of division and declare the spirit of unity. And I pray for your spirit and your breath of healing, forgiveness, and reconciliation to inundate this wonderful people and their families. Bless them mightily. God above, our Father, in Jesus' name, amen and amen. You've been awesome. Thank you for letting me talk to you. Tough topic. You are amazing. Yes, you are.